declare to you, my past is over in you. All things are made new, surrendered my life to Christ. I'm moving, moving forward. Oh. What a moment you have brought me to such a freedom. I have found in you, you're the healer who makes all things new. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Not going back, I'm moving ahead. I'm here to declare to you, my past is over in you. Things are made.
Those men are mystery. come and told I belong. At the end of the line, the only other not quite. We'll never get it right. But it turns out that the ones you were looking for all this time. Cause I'm just a nobody trying to tell everybody all about somebody who saved my soul. Ever since you rescued me, gave my heart a song to sing. Living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. Living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. Moses had such fight. You gave about a rock to a soul fight. Pick 12 outsiders, nobody would have chosen, and you changed the world. The moral of the story is everybody got a purpose. So when I hear that devil song talking to me, say, who do you think you are?
I'm just nobody trying to tell everybody all about somebody who saved my soul.
Cause I'm just a nobody trying to tell everybody all about somebody to save my soul. Ever since you rescued me, gave my heart a song to sing. I'm waiting for the world to see nobody but Jesus. Waiting for the world. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. How many know that Jesus has the power? In his name, there's power to move mountains, to do all things. Can we shout out his name?
Jesus!
Come on, we can do better than that.
Can we shout out his name?
Jesus!
That's right. Thank you, precious Lord. Father God, have your way, Father, in our lives, in the lives of our family, in our community, Lord. Just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind. Cause I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus. And I just want to speak the name of Jesus till every dark addiction starts to break. Declaring there is hope and there is freedom. I speak Jesus. Your name is power. Your name is healing. Your name is life. Break every stronghold.
Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name. Jesus,
come on, proclaim it.
Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets. Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name. Jesus, your name is power, your name is healing, your name is life.
Lord,
the glory of the Lord. Here comes the glory of the Lord, sweeping in the room.
Thank you, Lord.
Here comes the glory of the Lord. The glory of the Lord sweeping in the room. Here comes the glory of the Lord. Here comes the glory of the Lord.
Heaven is here right now. Heaven comes the glory of the Lord. Here comes the glory of the Lord, sweeping in the room.
Here comes the glory.
Here comes the glory of the Lord. Here comes the glory of the Lord, sweeping in the room. Here comes the glory of the Lord. Here comes the glory of the Lord, sweeping in the room.
Sing it with us.
Here comes the glory of the Lord. Here comes the glory of the Lord, sweeping in the room.
Thank you, Lord.
Here comes the glory of the Lord. Here comes the glory of the Lord, sweeping in the room.
We love you, Lord.
Here comes the glory of the Lord. Here comes the glory of the Lord, sweeping in the room.
Yes, Lord.
Here comes the glory of the Lord. Here comes the glory of the Lord, sweeping.
Hallelujah. Thank you, precious Lord.
Welcome to our Sunday service here at House Arrest, where Jesus is the senior pastor. We have a seat with your name on it. We appreciate you spending your Sunday morning with us. Established in 2011 and going strong in the name of Jesus. We're excited to announce the beginning of Holy Week, starting today with Palm Sunday service. Do something different. We have so many things going on. It's a perfect time to do something you've never done. Monday night, evangelize with us on the corner of I and 9th in downtown Modesto with the House Arrest evangelism team between the hours of 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. Tuesday night, join us for prayer and intercession in the main sanctuary here. Wednesday night at 6:30 to 8:30 with prayer, worship, and Bible study. Study with Pastor David Rocha. And while you're in the sanctuary, bring your youth so I could watch them for a biblical study and great fellowship. Please feed them before they come. Thursday night, our PLBS Bible School is having open house classes. Come and join us for a session, 5:30 p.m. to 6:30 p.m. on the four keys to hearing God's voice, or 7 p.m. to 8 p.m. for the course Counseled by God. Coffee and sweets are on us. Friday night, experience what it was like on the evening when the Lord was crucified, 7 p.m. to 8 p.m. You don't want to miss this. It's like nothing you've ever experienced. Saturday night, worship with Pastor George and his electric guitar. Old school blues and rock and roll hour of praising Jesus. Finally, next Sunday is our Resurrection Sunday service at 10 a.m. Bring your family on this special day as we remember our Lord's resurrection. Our vision statement is important to us. Number one, we love Jesus with no agenda. Number two, we teach identity in Christ by the power of the Holy Spirit with healing, deliverance, prophetic word, and biblical teaching. Number three, we teach to hear the voice of God. He still speaks today. Number four, before we are a church, we are a family. Thank you for joining us at the House Rest Church with over 5,000 churches across the globe. Welcome home. Say it again, roll it back.
Welcome. Amen. How's everyone doing today? Oh, there's a lot of you. Amen. Welcome to House of Rest Church on this Palm Sunday, the beginning of Holy Week. And before we get into any announcements, we want to make sure that we greet each other. If you see somebody behind you, in front of you, on the side of you, take a minute, say hello to them. Make sure you don't forget the media team up there. Those of you that are online, God bless you. Thank you for spending time with us. Thank you for watching us. God bless you. We appreciate all of you that you could be viewing something else, but you're here with us in this beautiful morning. And we just want to thank you all so, so much. We appreciate you. If you are not subscribed to the channel, make sure you subscribe. That way you can get our notifications, because every Sunday we have service. Every Wednesday we have our Bible study at night that we live stream. And when we do devotionals. So please make sure that you are subscribed on this Palm Sunday.
So in the meantime, I'm going to encourage you parents to make sure that your children go to class today. They do not want to miss out on what's going to take place in there today. I hope you registered your kids ahead of time. But if you didn't, please run and go do it right now. We encourage you for next time to please register them ahead of coming into service. They do not want to miss out today. It's going to be super, super special. It's special all the time, but it's going to be super special today. So please make sure that your children go to class today. They have something amazing in store for today. So I do want to make a quick announcement. I need my phone for this. Sorry, guys. I know. Oh, wrong one. I needed to give that to you, David. I was supposed to bring that to you. This is the right one, because I don't know how to pronounce stuff. I know how to pronounce Jesus. Oh, yeah. Okay, guys. So as we know, today we are going to be doing, can we put up the picture, please? How many know this little guy? Mighty Mateo, his fight is our fight. As you guys can probably see the banner we put up there, I hope you guys are hungry. Stay for the fundraiser, guys. Support, amen, yes.
They're gonna eat anyway somewhere.
Tell me that you ain't gonna go and leave here and go through a drive-thru, which is super expensive nowadays. You buy your kid a Happy Meal, you buy them a drink, and then they want a dessert or something later. You're going to end up spending a lot more out there than what you are here. Enjoy a meal here. And at the same time, you're supporting and you're giving to an amazing cause. Amen. So please, what we did do is in the youth sanctuary, I did set up some tables for those. They're all already set up in to-go boxes, so that if you do want to take it home, you're welcome to take it home. Made it so easy. See, I made it easy for you guys. Yeah, I was thinking about you guys in case you guys don't want to chill, but I did set up some tables inside the youth room. So if you want to eat here, you're welcome to eat here. If you want to sit on those three tables and stack yourselves up with people, that's fine. But wherever you guys want to eat, please just, join us after service. Amen. I just wanted to remind you guys of that. Thank you.
We had, didn't Isabel do good in that video? Where is she? I want your autograph. I have a few copies of the things that we're doing in Holy Week. Just let me explain something real quick. At House of Rest, what we do from Palm Sunday all the way to Resurrection Sunday is we have something going on every single night. I know most of you can't make it to every single thing, but our theme is this, is do something different. If you haven't been to evangelize, this is the week to do it. If you haven't been to a Wednesday Bible study, Or any of these things, guys. So if I can have an usher, one usher or two real quick. If this is the schedule, Monday through, from all the way from today to next Sunday, in case, because like Isabel did so awesome that you're just like mesmerized by the video and you're like, what day is this? What day is that? And if you can split that in two. If you guys want there's only so many. So if you can raise your hand, if you want them to hand you one of the schedule for Holy Week. If they run out, we'll print more before the service ends. As they're passing that out, guys, I just want to remind you that we continue to support missions. What we ask for in missions is $5, and your $5 gets split into five different ways on the ministries that you see on the screen. It is a huge blessing. We already have dates. We have Pastor Moses from Uganda coming April 21st. He's going to be here on that Sunday morning. And Pastor Thomas on May 5th, he will be here also. So these are two of the ministries. They try to make it every single year and to come and to share and see what God is doing on the other side of the world. You know, so those $5 are a huge, huge, huge support. With that also, guys, the offering and the tithing, again, I want to thank you guys so much for the fact that we're even here, you know, and it's a miracle that God put us here in this place. And I just know that God is going to do amazing things, and I sense it, and I say it every week because I believe that God is just doing something. And you know, it's not that we are waiting on God. It's God is waiting for us. And he wants to find a place that serves him, loves him, without agendas, without any of that stuff, to just be completely with your heart open, to have a pulpit where the pulpit belongs to him, where he's the senior pastor. Because this is about him. We're here for him. We're here to worship him, and we're here to live our lives that are in a way that are pleasing to him. And our whole thing is this, is we want to be able to continue to be a beacon of light in the city of Modesto. So if we can have a couple ushers again, and what we're going to do is if you need an envelope, they have envelopes. If you have one, they will take it from you and put it into the wooden mailbox. If you want to give online, of course, the different ways to give. There's so many different ways that people come that are popping up. So it's like we had Venmo, and then some of you were like, well, you don't have Cash App? You don't have? So we ended up getting all of them. Yes. Yeah, on the envelope, actually, we got new envelopes, and it has the Above and Beyond. Those of you who don't know what that is, it's the little envelopes that were hanging by the media. And for those of you that feel in your heart that you want to give your tithe and Above and Beyond, so that is also on the envelope, and also the children's ministry and the Unsheltered program is all on the envelope now also, right? So before I pray, I want to quickly say I want to thank all of you for your patience of everything that's been going on. For those of you that don't know, Thursday morning, you know that call you never want to get in the morning or in the middle of the night? Sharon got that call at 6 in the morning. Her brother-in-law was in a horrible accident, a fatal accident, and he's been in the family for 21 years. And it's her brother-in-law, but you say it's your brother. And it's been, you know, a lot of people flew out there because it happened in Utah. And we're about to have this fundraiser, and we're about to have Palm Sunday service, and we had grocery giveaway, and it has taken everything. You know, I'm just like, you know what, just forget all that, get on the plane, just go. And she was like, I have to be here, but she is leaving after service. I'm taking her to SFO so she can be with her sister. It was her little sister's husband. And she's going to be going for a few days. And so it hasn't been easy, guys. And a lot of times we don't understand, or we maybe get impatient. And please, you know, be patient with your pastor sometimes. because, you know, we're not excluded from things that happen in this world. You know, reality hits and real life things hit, you know, and a lot of times, you know, when somebody goes through something, you want to hide in your room, but when you're pastor in a church, you can't. And you have groceries, you know, Salvation Army saying the truck is here, you know, and we have to be here. And then we have to get the bags ready. And there's people and then families that are lining up for their groceries. And we can't. We don't have we can't just hide. And then with everything that's going on and all the meat that, you know, was gotten for everything, all the preparation for everything, you know, and I just want you to, I want you to remind you that we're human too. You know, we're human too. And, you know, she's going to be gone. So most of the Holy Week, I will be here, you know, but it's just please be patient with us. Thank you. You know, appreciate that. We're going to pray for the offering and for the tithing. Lord God, I thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your provision. I pray for every single dollar, every single penny that it be multiplied, Lord, so that we can continue to be here and take those funds and do what needs to be done with it so we can continue to minister your word, Lord, to share your gospel. I pray for every family that is here, for their livelihood, for their jobs, for their promotions, for promotions they need, for new job opportunities, for housing, for everything that I don't know the stories of what is going on here. I don't know who is sitting here just broken on their last leg, on the last string, saying, God, I need you right now, and I don't see you. I pray for that person too. We thank you, Lord, because you are always on the throne. And the things that happen on this earth do not shake you. The foundations of this world may shake, but you don't. And we find comfort in you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. In Jesus' mighty, mighty name, amen.
Hallelujah. Stand with me. That feeling sometimes when you just, you're in that place and you just want to run back to your first love. Just want to love you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. You just want to take a moment to just come back to your first love. Thank you, Lord. Jesus, you don't know me anything.
sorry when I just gone through the motions, and I'm sorry when I just sang another song. Take me back to where we started. I open up my heart to you. I'm sorry when I come with my agenda, and I'm sorry when I forget that you're enough. Take me back to where we started. I open up my heart to you. Caught up in your presence, I just wanna sit here at your feet. I'm caught up in this whole. Never want to leave. I'm not here for blessings. No, Jesus, you don't know me anything more than anything that you can do. I just. I just want you and nothing else, and nothing else, nothing else will do. I just want you and nothing else, nothing else, nothing else will do. I just want you, nothing else, nothing else, nothing else will do. I just want you, nothing else, nothing else, nothing else will do. I just want. Nothing else will do. Take me back to. Take me back to. Nothing else will do. Nothing else will do. Caught up in your presence, I just wanna sit here at your feet. I'm caught up in this holy moment. I never want to leave. Not here for blessings. No, Jesus, you don't know me.
Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, precious Lord.
Amen. The children's ministry, I was told, have a surprise. And I was told that I need to blow the shofar. So let's see what happens. I know. Oh, I know. Yeah, hold on.
Children, what are you wearing today?
I wear a fox. Armor of God.
Armor of God.
What are you wearing today? I'm a good dog.
What are you wearing today?
Armor of God.
They have been working really hard these last weeks to build their armor. From their shields to their swords, to the helmet of salvation, to the belt of truth, they have been learning and working. The hunger that these kids have is so enormous. Sometimes I come out of that room and I'm just blown away by these children. Can we give them an applause? Because of their hard work, we'd like to present them with something very special, because they, in turn, give something special back to us. So they're wearing their little helmets of salvation. They have their sword, which is their word of God. They're wearing their belts of truth. There you go, their belts of truth. And of course, they have their shoes. But they are all prepared and ready for battle. We're going to read your names off. If you can come forward, and you're just going to line up, okay? So this is their little armor of God, and we made it into a certificate for them so that they can keep it with them. And as a reminder, this one is for Victoria Rain. Victoria Rain. And they also are getting an armor of God necklace. Here, Mama. Go ahead and line up. Sophia? Is Sophia here? No. This is for Jesse. Jesse's not here today. Mia? She's older. Delilah? No, not today. Jeremiah? Stay right here, Papa. Stay right here. No name. Josiah? Hollis.
Thank you.
You want to grab your brother's hand? Xavier. Stay right here, Papa. Stay right here. Levi.
It's okay. You didn't hold on to it. Line up again.
Here, baby. Yeah. Cash. These are bigger. Anaya?
Ananaya or Anaya?
Is it Ananaya?
Ananaya or
Not here. Yeah. Okay. Amelia? Lily? Not today.
No.
That's right. I think those are all extras. Rose was in here. So yeah, Rose would be an extra. Rose, you can come forward now.
So that you can do it at home with your child, okay?
Are we giving one to Rose? Yeah, I already gave one to Rose.
Okay.
Yeah. And that's all of them?
Yeah. You don't have names.
Okay, so those are
Kahani.
Kahani?
Kahani?
Not here today. That's true. James is not here.
I'm calling all these parents and seeing where the kids are at.
Okay, if you guys like to come forward, we have a couple extra here for you guys to color in at the house, okay? You guys still get one, so that's wonderful. So here, each one of you get one of these.
Wait,
just wait. There you go. What's for
did you? Did you do one? She did one.
Here you go, Mama. We're going to have to give her a blank one. I don't see her name on them.
Did you take...
Is there any youth in the house? Come on down.
Didn't mean to steal the mic. Good morning, guys. The youth just have a little bit to say. I wanted them to come up here and tell you why Jesus is important to them. I think it's really important that we hear it from the youth. Because this week is all about Jesus. This week is all about him coming and sacrificing himself. And I want the youth to tell you what he means to them. Because it's very important. It brings encouragement to the body. So we're going to start with Oliver.
Hello, everybody. How's your guys' day going? This week is important to me because it is a significant time, because it's the time of the entrance and triumphant and the courage that Jesus took when he was walking to Jerusalem. He was supposed to build a spiritual kingdom there, which honestly, in my mind, it actually did happen because it's also important to me because it shows how he is going to lead the earth and the kingdom of God. It's important to me because throughout my life, it was hard. My parents split, and it was me and my mom. And he gave my mom the will to keep going because at the end of the day, there is still God. And then God led a man developing in Christ in my life. In our direction, to our left. To make a way in my life, just like when they were laying palms down. There is opportunity through God. He's like a flowing waterfall, and he can feed and help you through your life. Just like my life and others, Jesus is important to me because he gave me another shot at life when there was no light. My entire family was people that would drink and... they would even have anger. But God is reaching out. He helped me and my mom, and he is moving through my life. Even my tias, they are getting influenced by God when my mom... influenced through God when my mom shared the Bible with them. When my mom had me, she was told to get an abortion. But that little voice said, no. This makes me sad because that voice was God. There was a reason I was born, and even all of you guys.
Good morning, y'all. How y'all doing? I was ready to give a speech, but we're gonna ditch it. So she asked me, why is God important to me? And I couldn't give a definitive answer at the moment, and I still can't. But from seeing through my eyes and recognizing these people here that I have in my life now, I would like to shout out my dad for being 1 year at this church and almost being 1 year saved. I don't know where he's at right now. Can't see him in the crowd, but I'm just really happy for him. That's a big moment for him today. So I can't answer for me, but I can answer for my family. Seeing that my dad was a drunk before coming to this church and having a rough life at home, it was hard to understand life. But seeing my dad get saved made a great improvement in my life. Jesus saving my dad made a big moment for me. He brought back my father. He brought back the love into my house. And I can only be so happy for that. And so now I'm just waiting for that moment where he seeks me from that 99. So thank you for listening.
Good morning, everyone. I'm not giving a speech because Holy Oliver already did that for us. So thank you for that. And I'm just going to get straight to it because, yeah, I don't know. Okay, so. Okay. So Isabel on, what was it? It's Monday, Wednesday. She told me that I had to give a presentation on why Jesus is important to me. Did not know I was signed up for this. She signed me up for it. But Jesus is important to me because I've seen a change in my dad ever since he fell in love with Jesus. My dad is the reason why I've attended to church. I've always believed in him, but I never had that true relationship with him. But ever since I've started to attend, I've always believed in him, but I've never had a relationship with Jesus. Ever since I started attending church in the youth group, I've gained a true relationship with God on a deeper level. His love is like no other, and through him, I found true peace. I love my family here at House of Rest. They motivate me to stay strong in my faith.
There's one last person that I wanted to acknowledge. I wanted to acknowledge baby Mateo. So we were trying to get him to, we got him a little shirt that says Armor of God, and it had all the same little things that the children had, but he was gonna wear it in a t-shirt, and we were gonna have a picture of him from the hospital. So he isn't able to join us today because, you know, he had to go in. Oh, he's here? No! He made it! Is he wearing his t-shirt? Oh, you better bring him up here. No way. Mateo, get up here. He has his helmet on. He has a special medallion. And I have, we special ordered a special medallion for him that has a little boy in it. And this is for you. Yes, that's just for you. And he has his own little certificate that he gets to color with mom later. And I expect you to put your name on there. So he's wearing the armor of God, amen. So, all right. That is so awesome. Thank you for bringing him and for wearing that. Yes, that is so awesome. See? And I'm sitting here texting her right now over there. Can you send me a picture so I can put it up for them right now? Praise God. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I didn't know he was here.
All right. You're proud of those kids? Amen. You know what I noticed when all three youth spoke? Oliver said, when a man of God came into my life. Gabriel's son says, when my dad got saved. Mila, when my dad got saved. Men need to rise up and raise their families in the ways of God and be the example of your home. And for many women that don't have the man in their life, that's what we're here for. There's men here that'll say, I'll be the uncle, I'll be the friend, I'll be the mentor, I'll be the one that will pour into them, because it takes a village to raise our kids. That's important. Amen. So today on this Palm Sunday, I don't know if you know this or not, if you're visiting for the first time, usually a lot of times in churches, they'll use the holidays and give a really fluffy, kind of soft sermon. It ain't going to happen here. So I'm just saying, prep yourself. Lord God, I thank you for this opportunity to share your word. This pulpit belongs to you. You are the senior pastor of this church. We thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name, amen. The rocks will cry out is today's message. The rocks will cry out. I'm going to be reading out of Luke 19:28-40. I'm going to read this through, and then we're going to unpack this, and I'll just go ahead and read. I'm Luke 19:28-40, and it says this. Basically, let me set the stage first of all. The reason it's called Holy Week is because the week before Jesus was crucified, the week before he had the Last Supper, that beginning of that week, he came into Jerusalem. There was people that wanted him killed. There was people that hated his message. And he was coming into the lion's den. He was coming into the line of fire. Everybody knew around Jesus that if he would go into Jerusalem, it would be very dangerous for him. And with that, this is what happened on that Palm Sunday. It says in Luke 19:28, and when he had said these things, he went on ahead going up to Jerusalem. When it says he's talking about the Lord, when he drew near to Bethphage and Bethany, at the mount that is called Olivet, he sent two of his disciples. So he's right there on the outskirts of Jerusalem. Jerusalem is on a hill, and at the very top was the temple. That's why it says they went up to Jerusalem. And he said, go into the village in front of you, where on entering you will find a colt tied on which no one has ever sat. Untie it and bring it here like a donkey, right? He says, you know what? I need to come into Jerusalem, but the Lord knew, go to this place, this address, this street, and you're going to find a colt. Bring it to me because I have need for it. And that's where we're at here. And then it goes on. He says, untie it and bring it here. Verse 31, if anyone asks you, why are you untying it? You shall say this, the Lord has need of it. So those who were sent away and found it just as he had told them. So they go and they find it exactly the way he said. And as they were untying the colt, its owner said to them, why are you untying the colt? And they said, the Lord has need of it. And they brought it to Jesus, and throwing their cloaks on the colt, they set Jesus on it. And as he rode along, they spread their cloaks on the road. This is interesting, because normally when a king would come into a city, he would come on a horse to show his authority, to show his power, and instead he chose a humble animal. A humble animal, and they didn't want the Lord to sit on the animal just like that, so they put their cloaks on it as he sat on it. But it was interesting, because as he's coming into the city, there was many entrances, but there's specific entrance that he was coming in from the Mount of Olives. As he was coming down, they threw their cloaks on him, and they set Jesus on it. And as he rode along, they started to spread the cloaks on the road. They started to lay their jackets on the road because the king was about to come into the city of Jerusalem. And as the king was coming, it wasn't a red carpet. It was the cloaks of people. And as they were drawing near on the way down the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of his disciples began to rejoice and praise God with a loud voice for all the mighty works that they had seen. It's interesting because in one of the other gospels, those that didn't have cloaks started ripping palm branches off of the palm trees and started to lay them down as the donkey was walking and Jesus was on the donkey. And because when the king comes, you always want to present something for the king. And just imagine cloaks and palm branches as the king is walking in and everybody's cheering. Everybody is ecstatic. And the whole multitude of his disciples, you got to remember that there's the 12 disciples, the apostles, but disciple basically meant his students. So there was many of them. And as he was walking along, all of the disciples, all the followers of Jesus began to rejoice. And they began to praise God with a loud voice for all the mighty works that they had seen. They were shouting for Lazarus that he rose from the dead. They were shouting for the eyes that were open. They were shouting for the ears that were open. They were shouting for all of the healings that were taking place around the Lord. They were shouting for the words that he spoke. And they just started to worship. And then in verse 38, they started to say, "Blessed is the king who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest." They began to call him a king. Now, you got to remember, this is in occupied Jerusalem, occupied by the Roman government. And the people were shouting, "Blessed is the king who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest." And some of the Pharisees, they were very religious. They were in the crowd and they started yelling to Jesus saying, "Teacher, rebuke your disciples." And Jesus answered, "I tell you, if these were silent, the very stones would cry out." Sermon's done. No, just playing. You know, this whole thing that we've been talking about over the last few weeks, we've been talking about all the way from the very beginning because we had to begin in the beginning a few weeks ago because everything built up to this moment. It built up to this. And we got to start in the beginning. So even from the Garden of Eden, we see that authority and the identity of Adam and Eve were stolen by the enemy, by the serpent, deceived and tricked and twisted the scripture. And we see that in the very beginning, the fall. And at that time and that moment, man was stained with sin and it wouldn't wash off. There was no vaccine for it. You couldn't go to CVS and say, "Hey, you got something for this sin." You were stuck with it, and not only were you stuck with it, the moment you had children, they were stained in it also. And the generations were stained. And last week we saw, because here's the thing that God knew and understood, because he prophesied when Adam and Eve were there, and he says, "Out of you, woman, will come one that will step on the serpent's head." Now you got to understand that the enemy heard this. The enemy heard this and said, "Oh, so if the one that's going to step on my head is going to come from a woman, then I'm declaring war on mankind." Because from the very beginning, We know that God has always made that promise that out of that woman would come the one that would step on the serpent. So it's been a war from that moment on. And then last week we talked about the sons of God because, you know, I'm going to quickly summarize just to catch some of you up. Many times we think of the fall only from the creation and Adam and Eve and eating from the tree, but there was many rebellions within that fall. There was the rebellion of that, what happened in the Garden of Eden, because the Bible says that Satan was a guardian cherub. He was a guardian angel. Many times people say, why, if God is so good, why was Satan there? But if you go to Ezekiel, if you go to the scriptures, it says that he was the guardian cherub, the most anointed one, the one the Lord trusted the most. And it even says, "You, O guardian cherub, when did sin come into your heart?" How many of you have ever been betrayed? Backstabbed, bamboozled. It don't feel good, does it? The Lord put his most trusted, most beautiful cherub to guard the garden. And what does he do? Deceives. But there's another time that we see in Genesis right before the flood, and we talked about it last week, where the sons of God, because we read through the scriptures, that there's a council. Is that scripture still up there from last week, Benjamin? No? All right. If it is, it is. If it ain't, then it ain't. But basically, we read on the scripture that God sits in a council, and these council were called the sons of God. What? Oh, I thought he said something. That must have been the Lord. And in the council, there's sons of God, and we had these poster. But where are those poster boards? They're right there, brother. Let's reenact that really fast. Okay, I need six people. Well, five, because he'll be one. Just real quick, let's do this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. One more. All right, hold it to the... Now stand up here more and show the white side. Okay, so the Bible says, oh, there it is. Psalm 82, 1 says, God has taken his place in the divine council. In the midst of God's, he holds judgment. There's a council of God that the Bible talks about. That's a whole other sermon. And watch last week's if you're confused. But the Bible says that the sons of God saw women and they did something horrible, something that was out of their place, something that was out of their domain. And they came down and basically they rebelled against God once again. And because of that, the council fell. Now step down one step and flip it over. On the step, brother. So these sons of God came down. And basically, then the flood came. God says, I'm going to wipe this whole thing out. You guys messed up. I got to get rid of everything and start all over with Noah. And he finds Noah. And he brings the flood. But then mankind became wicked again. They built a tower. They called the Tower of Babel. And in the Tower of Babel, in Deuteronomy 32:8, it says this. We've read this last week also. It says, when the Most High gave to the nations their inheritance. Change the scripture. The one right now. It shows it on the screen here. Yeah. Yeah, there it is. When the Most High gave their nations... gave to the nations their inheritance. When he divided mankind, he fixed the borders of the people according to the number of the sons of God. So basically, the people were rebelling. The sons of God were rebelling. And he said, oh, you guys deserve each other. I'll tell you what, you don't need me. I'll give you your gods. That's the gods you want. Go ahead. And these sons of God created for themselves names, demons. And these are the names that you see. I'm just going to quickly read them. There's many more. This is just an example. But one of the sons of God says, my name is Dagon. I'll be the god of the Philistines. Molech, I'll be the god of the Ammonite. Ra, I'll be the god of Egypt. Chemosh, I'll be the god of Moab. Baal, I'll be the god of Canaan. Ashtoreth, I'll be the god, the Phoenician god. And there's many more. That's why it says here, he fixed the borders of the people according to the number of the sons of God. So each of them had their own nation. So since you guys think you do it better than I do, then there's your people, there's your people, there's your people. So now, a nation came out of you. Now step down one more time. So now these are nations. And there are nations above them. Okay, we can sit now. That's the quick recap. I'm not trying to redo last week. But we see that they rebelled. Each of them became a nation. And these nations now each started to grow in their wickedness and they worship their gods. And why do you think you go back and you see like when the hieroglyphics and things like that you find in caves and they always have a god that they worshiped? They didn't make that up. There was a wicked son of God. The Bible says that they are not gods, they're demons. And they caused the people to worship them. Some of them, the Bible says that the ones that went to the women, it says some of them were so wicked that they were thrown in prison. And the Bible says even under the river Euphrates, that they were locked in chains forever until the end. God had enough of it, and he allowed the fallen sons of God to have their regions, their nations, their principalities. You know how scripture says we don't fight against flesh and blood, but against principalities and high places? That's what that means. A principality is a region because there's a prince over it, and over that prince is his principality. So imagine each of these gods were princes. And their principality was the people under them. You know, and it keeps going smaller and smaller. In the same way, like in the United States, there's the president. And then it goes down, there's governors. And then it goes down and there's mayors. And it goes, you know, however the hierarchy is. Because how many of you know that, have you ever gone to a city and you feel something different? There's a different principality. You go to San Francisco, there's a different principality. You go to Oakland, there's a different principality. You go to Stockton, there's a different principality. You go even neighborhoods. It all comes down. And you sense the shift. You sense that something's different in this place. There's times I remember being called to preach. And I remember driving down the freeway. And it's almost as soon as I hit the city limits of that place where I was called to give my testimony or to share, I could almost feel the oppression saying, get out. Stay out of here. And, you know, greater is he who's in us than he who's in the world. So I keep going. But nevertheless, you can sense it. You can feel it. Now, with all this ruckus going on and these sons of God turned demonic, and now they are gods to their nations. And that's why God called Abraham. And he says, you know what? Since you guys think you got it on your own, go ahead, have at it. I will create a nation and I will have my own people and they will worship me. And that's when he called Abraham. And out of Abraham, he told them, whoever curses you, I will curse him. Whoever blesses you, I will bless you. I will be your God. And he raised up Abraham, and Abraham had Isaac, and Isaac had Jacob, and the nation grew. They fell into slavery in Egypt. And then after 400 years, God raised up Moses. And after God raised up Moses, he says, I want you to tell them that I need them to be free because I need to put them in the land that I gave them. Remember how we saw in the scripture that said God allowed the nations according to the sons of God. So each of them, God gave them a region. Here's just a funny thing about it, that even the enemy, even his principality was given to him by the enemy. He don't have no say. So God's like, you know why you have that land, Canaan? You know why you have that line, Ashtoreth? Because I gave it to you, but only for a short time. Because God's always in control. But nevertheless, they are the gods of those nations. And God says, I'll raise up a people. And out of those people will come the promise that I told Adam and Eve. the promise that out of a woman would come the one that would crush the enemy. Why do you think Israel was attacked so much? Because the enemy knew that out of Israel would come the Messiah, would come the anointed one to destroy all of these kingdoms. That is why. That is why the nation was attacked so much. It was surrounded by enemies. It was surrounded by all of these and more. And God told his people, he says, do not mix with them, because if you marry your sons to them, then your sons will worship their gods. You are a peculiar people. You are my people. Set yourself apart from them. Be separate. Be holy, because I am holy, says the Lord. Now, the Bible says that Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. So why is it that nowadays that the church wants to be the world, look like the world so bad? These gods didn't die. They're still alive. They just changed their name. And God says, come to the church. Give your life to me. Be a peculiar people. Be a priest in your household. And be separate from the world. You are not of this world. Be holy, because I am holy. But the church today don't want to hear that. The church wants to look like the world so bad. And what did God say in the very beginning? He says, do not mix yourself with them, because you will be drawn to worship their gods. And that becomes the issue. That becomes a problem. As you can see, it was a problem back then. It's a problem today. But God said, I'm going to raise up a nation of my own. What did all this have to do with Palm Sunday, though? What does it have to do with it? Now, remember, like we said, the fallen sons of God, they lost their position, but created nations of people who worship them. And the Bible says that those gods are nothing but demons. Remember that. But God said, the day is going to come when I will raise up a nation, and out of that nation will come the anointed one. And he is going to destroy the strongholds of the enemy. The anointed one. See, here's the thing about a lot of the people at that time of Jesus, is they thought the enemy was Rome, because they were oppressing them. And the Lord is like, I'm not coming to fight Rome. There are bigger kingdoms that I came to destroy. Kingdoms you cannot see. Kingdoms that have enslaved the people. Kingdoms that have the people bound. I'm coming against Baal. I'm coming against Ashtoreth. I'm coming against Chemosh. I'm coming against all of these demons. See, a lot of times we don't see the big picture. We think that because somebody doesn't understand Christianity, doesn't understand Jesus, we think those are our enemies, or protesters, we think those are our enemies. And Jesus was like, listen, Rome isn't the enemy, it's what's behind it. And he's saying the same thing to us. We don't fight against flesh and blood. Our enemies are not other people. Our enemies are not other people. Our enemies are not the politicians you don't like. Here's the thing, by default, if you do not serve God, you're serving one of these demons. And Jesus says it's the blind leading the blind. So instead of complaining, why don't you pray for them, for God to set them free? Because if you were set free and I was set free, then that means they could be set free too. See, the enemy, he wants you to attack the Roman, not the spiritual prince over that principality. The Bible says we're in a spiritual warfare. Why do you think these kids were learning about the armor of God? They're not going to go fight physical fights. They're fighting bigger battles than that. But nevertheless, the Lord was born through Mary, exactly like the prophecy said. And the Lord was raised up in the household of Mary and his stepfather Joseph. And Joseph must have been an amazing man of God for him to be chosen to be the one to raise Jesus. And throughout all of that time, because even in the beginning, the Bible says that when Jesus was born, that Herod, the king of Israel at that time, he said, I'm not going to let some little baby take over my throne. He was, I tell you what, why don't you go to Bethlehem and kill every two-year-old boy, two or younger, just to make sure we get him. But Jesus got away. The Bible said that an angel appeared and to Joseph says, take Jesus to Egypt, and I'll tell you when to come back. So even from the very beginning, it's like the enemy was like, I think I got him. I ordered Herod to kill all the babies, the boys, two or for sure I got him. Here's the thing is that Satan is not all-knowing. Satan cannot read your thoughts. Don't give him that. He will make you believe so. He can't. There's only one that can know you, that knows your heart and your thoughts, and that's the Lord Jesus Christ. That's it. He's the only one. But I have a feeling that the enemy was like, man, how can I find him? Because, you know, I don't know. I mean, sometimes we could be blinded by pride. I don't know if the enemy was like, okay, we killed all the babies, so okay, he's done. Or was he like, man, I know how the Lord works. I got to figure out who he is. You know, the Bible says that Jesus grew. He became an adult. At 30 years old, he went to be baptized by John the Baptist. And when John saw Jesus, he tells the disciples, look, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. And people began to proclaim who Jesus was. And Jesus lived an amazing ministry for 3.5 years. He went preaching the gospel, preaching the kingdom, preaching repentance. Blind eyes were open. Mute ears were opened. The sick were getting up. The dead were being raised. And the power of God was moving. And everywhere Jesus went, there was crowds. And it was like something no one had ever seen. You don't think that caught the eye of the enemy? Why do you think when Jesus went to fast for 40 days and 40 nights, it's like Satan was trying to figure it out. And he says, if you are the Son of God, make these rocks into bread. And Jesus always came back with the word. And it's almost like he was taunting. And sometimes I wonder, was he wondering who he was, or was he taunting him? It could go either way. But nevertheless, we see there that there was a wondering if the enemy was saying, man, I think this one's different. He's not like Moses. He's not like Abraham. He's not like Ezekiel. He's not like Daniel. And even the Bible says that when he spoke with an authority. There was something about Jesus. The little kids would want to rush to him. There was something about the way he spoke. Matter of fact, he was on a boat, and the boat was waving and tossing to and fro, and the disciples are freaking out. And they're like, where's Jesus? He's asleep? He's asleep in the middle of a storm? And they wake Jesus up, and Jesus got annoyed. He's like, oh, you of little faith. And he walks up to the boat, looks at the ocean, and he commands it to calm. And the moment he said it, the storm calmed down. And even his own disciples said, what man is this that even the weather obeys him? Man. Whew. What man is this that even the weather obeys him? Man. But then as time goes on, you know, the Lord can blind anybody he wants and take blinders off anyone he wants. And the thing is this, is that Satan, no matter what, how cunning, the Bible even says he was cunning, he's only going to be able to see as much as the Lord allows him to see. Because God is still God of the atheist. God is still God of the pagan. God is still God, whether they acknowledge him or not. He's still God. He's still Lord. Doesn't change nothing. But then in Deuteronomy 32, 16, 17, let me read this. It says, they stirred him to jealousy with strange gods. With abominations, they provoked him to anger. Talking about Israel. And it says, they sacrificed to demons that were no gods, to gods they had never known. So Israel, before Jesus, his own nation, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and Moses, and King David, all these, and even his own nation, in the midst of all these sons of God that went bad, it stirred up a jealousy in him. What do you think that in the Bible says he's a jealous God? Because you belong to him. You belong to him, and the nation of Israel belonged to him. And over time, Israel started to worship these gods, and it stirred the jealousy of the Lord. And they did abominations, and it provoked the Lord to anger. And they sacrificed to demons that were no gods, to gods they had never known, to new gods that had come recently. Huh. New gods. Whom your fathers had never dreaded. You know, by default, for instance, like in the United States, when they talk about the people that established this nation, they say our forefathers, right? So in a sense, the people are looked at in a sense as the fathers of this nation. So what do you think happened to the nations who followed after their demon? Didn't their demon become their father? So in essence, according to scripture, that these nations, you know how everybody says, oh, we're all God's children. No, that's not Bible. I'm sorry. It sounds nice. It ain't Bible. Because there's even in a part where Jesus is arguing with these religious people, and he says, you sound like your father. And they said, what do you mean? Our father's Abraham, they told him. They're claiming to Abraham. Our father's Abraham. And he says, oh, before Abraham, I was. And they said, what do you mean? You're not even 30 years old, and you're claiming to know Abraham? And he says, no. You're like your father, the devil. That's your father. He's the father of lies, and when he speaks lies, he's speaking his own language. That's who your father is. So, by default, when we were not in Christ, that means we were under some demon's principality. And there was a prince over that principality. And that means we were children of that demon. It's an ugly thought. But let me tell you this, is that just because somebody abducts your child at a gas station and raises that child for 10 years and you can't find him does not make the abductor their father, does not make the abductor their parents. That's the wrongful parent. That is not the rightfully, that child does not rightfully belong to you. You're the thief. Why do you think the Lord can forgive you of your sins? Because you had been abducted by a thief. And some of you were abducted at a very young age. Your innocence was robbed from you and stolen from you. And the Lord says, I forgive you, I love you. And many of us are so broken and shattered and say, Lord, how can you love me? Everything I've done against you, everything I've done to myself, everything I've done to hurt all the people around me. And the Lord says, yeah, because the abductor has spoken lies to you, but that's not who you are. I have something greater for you. I have something better for you. That's not your identity. That's not who you are. You don't belong to these filthy demons. You belong to me, the Lord says. Why do you think he came to die? People say, why did he have to go that far to die? Because you're worth it. That's why. You are worth it. He says, I know where my son is. I know where my daughter is. It's like somebody taking your child and then they call and say, we want a ransom of $2 million. And it's like the Lord is like, you gods have stolen my children. What's the ransom? And the demons all in one place, like it sounded like harmony. They said, your life. And he says, I'll leave the 99 to go and seek the one. And I lay my life down. Matter of fact, you don't lay my life down. I lay my life down. But after 3 days, I will take my life back. Why do you think he came to die? He came to shed his blood. The shedding of his blood is a ransom payment. It's a ransom payment. But by default, we became children of demons. In Romans 6:16, it says this. Do you not know that if you present yourselves to anyone as obedient slaves, you are slaves of the one you obey? Either of sin, which leads to death, or of obedience, which leads to righteousness. What does that mean? Is the voice you obey, you become a slave to it. Quit listening to demons. I don't have arguments with demons. Sometimes we want to because it'll look good on our YouTube channel. And while the enemy humiliates you and makes you squirm like a worm on the floor and scream out. And the whole time we're, this will get me some views. This will get me some subscribers. No. Our job is not to build up a YouTube channel on the enemy humiliating people. Our job is to set people free in the name of Jesus, and that is it. I will not have an argument with you. I don't want to talk to you. I don't care how long you say you've been there. It doesn't matter to me. All I know is I'm serving an eviction notice. There's a new sheriff in town. And my badge is the Holy Ghost. And I'm commanding you in the name of Jesus to come out. I don't want to hear what you have to say. Because Jesus says, my God, my Savior says you're a liar and everything you say is lies. So why even talk to you for? So you got to be careful. The one you obey, you become a slave to that voice. That argument that Jesus had, he tells him in John 8, 44 and 45. He says, you are of your father, the devil, and your will is to do your father's desires. He was a murderer from the beginning and does not stand in the truth because there is no truth in him. And when he lies, he speaks out of his own character. For he is a liar and the father of lies. But because I tell the truth, you don't believe me. This is what Jesus said. So, all of this history that I've been talking about the last few weeks, and it all comes down to this. It's the last week before the crucifixion. Jesus is about to come into Jerusalem. People start laying their cloaks down. People start taking palm leaves and laying them down because the king is about to come. But he's coming on a donkey. Do you understand what he is doing? He's about to declare war. He's about to declare war on all of these false gods, all of these demons. He's about to come in, and he ain't even scared, so he's not on a horse. He goes, man, I'll come in on a donkey, and I'll still take this thing over. As he rode along, they spread their cloaks in the road. As he was drawing near all the way down the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of the disciples, they began to rejoice and praise God with a loud voice for all the mighty works they had seen. And everybody starts shouting. Oh, man. That's like, you know, We some of us like watching boxing, and when we're like, man, what song is that boxer gonna pick when he comes down, you know? And that boxer comes and it's like boom, smoke comes out. I'm thinking of the movie Rocky IV. You know, the smoke comes out and everything, and the Russian guy comes out. You know, here's the thing, and notice the difference. Like, didn't the Russian guy have all this lights and smoke and all this crazy stuff? And then in Rocky's turn, he just comes out like, just, hey, Adrian. You know what I mean? Like, just he just comes, you know? See, Jesus don't need your smoke machines. Jesus don't mean your strobe lights. Jesus don't need the new song from somebody that did it. He just says, man, give me a donkey. I'm about to show all of these demons who's about to come. I'm going to come and destroy the works of the enemy. And he's coming into Jerusalem. And that's exciting unto itself on Palm Sunday. That's exciting enough. But the Pharisees, the religious, they started to tell him, rebuke your disciples. Tell them to stop worshiping. Tell them to stop all that. Tell them that that's too much. Tell them to quit that. And I love the fact that he says, if I tell them to stop, then the rocks will praise me. The rocks will shout. And I remember I thought that was interesting because I obviously it's not that the rocks have little mouths. It's that God was saying, he's not saying like little rocks, like little arms and legs are going to pop out of a rock and they're going to start worshiping. That's weird. You guys all pictured it, huh? No, it goes so much deeper, guys. You know why? This is the part. This is the part. Is that... When I say, man, give me something that has no life. You can't say a tree because a tree has life. You can't say a branch or a fish, it has life. And you're just like, okay, what has no life? And it comes down to saying, you know what? These rocks have no life. They're dead. There's nothing. There's no life. There's no nothing. Even a clam or an oyster has life in it. Right? But and it's like the thing that has no life at all are the rocks. And Jesus says, if they don't worship, then the rocks will. That which is dead, completely dead, that has no life, they will shout. And I started thinking, and yesterday, you know, I've been, you know, when Sharon got the call, it was horrible, guys, because we still didn't know, because her sister was talking to her husband as he was on his way to work, and all of a sudden the line went dead, and his iPhone showed the GPS on the freeway, and it stopped moving. And she got scared and got in her car and started going in that direction. And she called Sharon and said, Sharon, please pray. Please pray. I think something happened to him. I think something happened to him. And I woke up to this as she pulled up to that. In that moment. And we were driving on the freeway, and I'm just like, and I just put some worship on. It was yesterday on the way to the grocery giveaway, and we're driving. And I put worship on. And all of a sudden, like, I knew what I was going to preach. I've known what I was going to preach because this is a series. And it's like, I remember as we pulled up to, like, right where the Grubhub is at, I the song finished that we were listening to. It was that song, Yeshua. And right when it finished, I looked at her. I said, the Lord showed me the sermon. And she goes, what do you mean? I said, he didn't tell it to me. He just showed it to me. I just saw it. And she goes, what do you mean? And this is what I saw. I saw him coming into the city, and I could see it in the, through the eyes of my heart. and I saw him on a donkey, and I couldn't see his face. And people are laying palm leaves down and their cloaks down. And he's walking into Jerusalem. And you could hear the noise and the roar of the people that were shouting for him. All the disciples that were shouting in excitement for him. And I for a second, like I didn't see his face, but I saw his eyes, because it's like his heart was broken when he saw a city that was about to reject him. And his own people, some of them that were going to reject him, and the city was going to reject him, and the religious were going to reject him. And I could see it so clear. And I was just getting off of 99, and I was turning on that street, and I saw all of this. And then I saw the religious say, "Tell them to stop shouting." And he says, "If I tell them to stop, then the rocks will shout." And he pointed at me. There wasn't rocks. It was us. It was us, and we were there, and we were dead, and we had no life, and there was no life in us anymore, and we were just deserving to be on the roadside just for things, just for animals and people to step on. And all of a sudden, he looked at me, and he says, "If they don't worship me, will you shout for me? Will you shout for me? Because if they don't worship me, then the rocks will." And in the vision, I began to shout, and then I snapped out of it, and I was by the Grubhub. And he's saying that to you today on this Palm Sunday. He's looking right at you, and he said, "There's some people in this earth that don't accept me as king. But that's all right, because you know what? If they won't worship me, then will you? If they won't shout for me, will you? If they won't praise for me, will you? If they won't bless me, will you? Because if not, then the rocks will." And I'm telling you, I want to be a rock then. I want to be the one that shouts. I want to be the one, because man, if the world doesn't want him, then I do. "Yes, Lord, I don't know what's wrong with them, but I'll do it. I'll worship you. I'll praise you. I'll bless you. Blessed is the king who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the king who comes in the name of the Lord." Palm Sunday is a declaration of war. Remember what I said, these sons of God? They were in the council of God, and they turned their back against the Lord, and they made a nation that was against God, and they became the children of that God. And the Lord is like, "Those aren't my children. Those are your children, because they lie just like you, because my children don't lie. My children are set apart. My children are holy. You act like your father." Do you know why the sons of God, the previous sons of God, hate you so much? Because they lost their position in heaven. They don't have that place anymore. They got fired, 86th. They got kicked out. And this is interesting, because and maybe this will make more sense to you as we wrap this up. In John chapter 1, verse 10 through 13, this blows me away, because it says, "He was in the world, and the world was made through him. Yet the world did not know him. They didn't shout for him. They didn't worship him. But it says he came to his own, and his own people didn't receive him. But to all who did receive him," look at this, "who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God." In other words, you become and replace these sons of God that were here. Man, they're 86. They're out of there. And there's an open place in heaven. And the Lord said, "If they won't worship me, then the rocks will. And they will raise up. And they will stand for me. And they will preach my name and speak my name." Because when we believe in his name, we are given the right to become children of God. who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor the will of man, but of God. These were angelic beings, and they chose to rebel against the holy God. Why do you think the Bible says that we will judge angels? These sons of God lived in heaven in the past. They were beautiful. Some of you are beautiful, but they were more beautiful. They were glorious. Some of you sing beautiful, but they sang more beautiful. And God created us out of the dust of the earth. It's almost like a slap to their face when the Lord says, "You won't praise me? Then the rocks will. I will raise up a people to myself." Those sinners, those alcoholics, those drug addicts, those gangbangers, those convicts, you're going to replace our job with them? And the Lord's like, "That's right." He says, what did he say? He goes, "Go and invite them. Invite all my friends to my dinner. I have a great dinner for them. Invite them all, bring them." And they went. And then all of them said, "Well, I don't have time. I got to do this. I got to do that." And they came back to the Lord and say, "All of your friends are busy." And he says, "Is that right?" He goes, "Well, the food's made and the plates are made and the food is warm. Go to the highways and the byways. Go and reach the woes that are rejected, because my house will be filled. My house will have a dinner. My house will have rejoicing, because if they don't want to come, I will find people that do." And I don't know about you, but that's me. That's me. And I'm just like, "Man, Lord, I want a place in that table. I want a place right there." Let's all stand. I pray in the name of Jesus that you have a deeper understanding for Palm Sunday, that you have a deeper understanding what this week means as we approach Resurrection Day, that you get that schedule and you do something different this week, that you realize that it is a declaration of war. I want you to go home and be like, "You know what, devil, whatever you're trying to do to my household, whatever you're trying to do to my marriage, whatever you're trying to do to my children, whatever you're trying to do to my family, Jesus 2,000 years ago declared war against all these gods. So you know what? I'm declaring war right now in my house. I'm declaring war in my marriage. I'm declaring war in my family. And I'm going to use this Palm Sunday, devil, because you know what? The one that's with me is greater than you. There's no weapon formed against me that will prosper. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. There is nothing. I am more than a conqueror. I know who I am. I know who I serve." So we're going to open these altars and kick off this Holy Week with some worship. We're going to open these altars. If anyone here, before we start, if you have not given your life to the Lord, you know what would be a good testimony? To say, "Man, I got saved on Palm Sunday. I got saved on the very day that the Lord declared war, and he's declaring war against everything that has held me down." Let today be the day and the moment, whether you come up here, whether you're there or watching online. But I want you to come and be a part of the kingdom of God. He's done so much for you. He's cried out for you. And it's now your turn to cry out for him. If that is you, I want you to repeat after me, but you got to mean it with all your heart. And say, "Lord God, I repent. I repent of all my sins. I believe you died on the cross. And after 3 days, you rose in power. Take out my heart of stone. I don't want to be a rock anymore. Bring me back to life. I want to serve you all the days of my life. From this moment on, I surrender it all to you. In Jesus' name, Amen. 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 Let's give the Lord a hand. If you pray that prayer, I want to pray for you in the name of Jesus. I command all chains to be broken. Any demon that has had a stronghold on you, I command that spirit to let go now. You are now the property of the Lord. He has taken back what belongs to him rightfully. Any cloudiness of mind, I command it to clear up in the name of Jesus right now. I declare freedom over every person that surrendered their life to you, Lord. I pray for every person that is here, the brokenhearted, the broken, those that are in pain. In the name of Jesus, I come against that pain right now. In Jesus' name, go now by the power of the living God. In Jesus' name. Let's worship. Let's worship. Come on. Let's take a moment. Let's start this week right. Let's start this week right.
Precious Father, Lord Jesus. Oh, I thank you.
you because of what you did on the cross 2,000 years ago, Lord. You are so good.
Thank you, precious Lord. Have your way, precious Lord.
Yes, Lord. Glory! Thank you, Jesus. You are the King of all kings, the Lord of all lords. The Alpha, the Omega, the beginning and the end. You are the anointed one. You are the powerful one. Yes, Lord, you are love. You are the truth. There is no other but you. You're the only one that sits on the throne, the creator of all things. You share your glory with no one. Person in this sanctuary, those that are watching, I pray for the Lord to shine his face upon you, that you do something different on this holy week. And we know and understand that we worship him every day of the year, but it's a good time to recalibrate your life, to recalibrate. If you haven't been reading your word, let this Holy Week begin so you start reading your word again. You start worshiping again. You spend time in prayer again. Let this be a recalibration, a reset. For those of you that are online, those of you that are watching, God bless you on this Sunday. Do something different. Do something different, man. Those of you that are living in that old life, it leads to nothing. How many times do you have to stumble and fall flat on your face when He is there the whole time? God bless you guys. Thank you so much. Don't forget that we have the fundraiser for Mateo. There's places to sit and eat in the youth. It's a fundraiser, so if you have the means, give more, because all of it is going to go toward Mateo. They need the funds.
There's tickets being sold to your right-hand side, so if you go to the right side, you'll see the tickets being sold. They're color-coordinated, so please look at the ticket area.
If there's anybody online, I know I can't send you a taco, but if you have it in your heart, please... For little Mateo, whatever is sent at this point right here, in whatever way, let us know. And we will give it to them because they really, truly need it. They need family right now. God bless you. Thank you so much.